Thank you. Some people still consider the First Symphony of Brahms the best of the four that he wrote, and certainly it affords the best possible introduction to his works in that form. The key of this symphony is C minor, the same as Beethoven's Fifth, and it also shares with that classic the underlying idea of man's struggle against fate. But the so-called knocking at the door is this time suggested by a relentless beat of the kettle drums in slow triplets, while the other instruments go soaring up the scale as though ambitious to reach the sky. Here's the way Brahms challenges fate at the very start of his First Symphony. This portentous opening soon turns into a belligerent theme, which indicates that the battle is on. There is a quiet interlude based on this theme, hinting that the first skirmish has resulted in a victory over fate. We seem to hear exultant cries, and then the strings tear viciously at a minor phrase that turns into a second theme whose mood is definitely triumphant. Listening to the complicated maneuvers of these themes is like watching an army in battle through field glasses. At the end, it would seem that fate has been conquered, but of course, this is only the first movement of the Brahms Symphony No. 1. Let's hear it all the way through in the recording of the Austrian Symphony Orchestra conducted by the American H. Arthur Brown. The mood becomes quite melancholy in the second movement of this first Brahms Symphony. The opening melody is very slow and sad, with heavy harmonies, but even here there's a note of courage, as though mankind were not yet ready to admit defeat. Following this mournful opening, a more cheerful theme is soon heard in the form of an oboe solo, foretelling the confident melodic line of the third movement still to come. In the end, the melancholy theme makes a beautiful change of melody and harmony, which seems to say we shall not fail, preparing the way for a victory over fate that will eventually be complete. I consider this slow movement by Brahms one of the most soul-searching passages in all music. At the start of the third movement of Brahms' First Symphony, we hear the complete melody at which the oboe had already hinted, this time carried by two clarinets. It has a wonderful calmness of mood, as though reminding us that the world is a beautiful place to live in, that there's no excuse for selfishness and evil. There's an inevitability in this theme that makes it hard to believe that Brahms worked it out as gradually and carefully as the previous movement had indicated. This is just one of those wonderful tunes that can only be credited to inspiration, regardless of whether it's developed slowly or arrives on the spur of the moment. The calmness of that lovely theme is not permitted to monopolize this third section of the Brahms Symphony. We get another reminder of the force of destiny through a deliberate echo of Beethoven's own fate motto in a triple rhythm, first on one tone as though saying, "Let me in," and then in the form of a definite melody which can be considered the second theme of the movement. Here is how fate returns to the battle. This time the struggle does not seem too violent, and the final repetition of the chief theme would seem to tell us that all is well. The movement is so beautiful musically that it hardly needs an artificial program. The recording of H. Arthur Brown and the Austrian Symphony Orchestra gives it a complete interpretation, so just relax and listen. The finale of the first Brahms Symphony is a complicated piece of music, summing up the full significance of the earlier movements and dramatizing once for all the eternal battle between man and his destiny. At the start, the orchestra seems to utter a despairing wail as if all were lost, and it takes quite a bit of time to arrive at anything that sounds at all like a sustained melody. Actually, one of the most familiar patterns is heard in a comparatively short horn call repeated by the flute, which may remind some of you of the notes of the Westminster chime. Brahms may have been implying a compliment to his British friends in that melody, but he himself claimed to have heard those notes on an alpine horn in Switzerland, so we'll have to take his word for it. The alpine theme is followed immediately by a brief chorale in the brass, definitely calculated to restore confidence. The stage is now set for the most popular theme in the entire symphony, the stately and stirring march, which seems to bring us right up to the gates of heaven itself. Has been accused of imitating the choral theme of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony in this march, and possibly he was deliberately paying his respects to the composer he venerated above all others. Actually, there's only a very slight resemblance in the second part of these two melodies. After the sustained climax of the march theme, Brahms indulges in some final flurries as though looking for a worthy ending to his demonstration of man's triumph over fate. The Alpine horn is heard again, and suddenly the heavens appear to open as the brass choir intones the chorale once more in a final climax of tremendous power. Nothing can top this, and Brahms wisely brings his great symphony to a close as quickly as possible in what for him is a fairly conventional coda. No wonder this first Brahms symphony has been called the 10th, meaning that it's the only one worthy to follow the immortal nine of Beethoven himself.